Thank you. So now we'll hear from Dr. Robert Kahn, who will provide an overview of the work of the Cincinnati Children's Hospital. Dr. Kahn is a professor and associate director of the Division of General and Community Pediatrics at the University of Cincinnati College of Medicine. He is co-director of the Cincinnati Child Health Law Partnership, and his research focuses on the intersection of poverty and child health. Dr. Kahn?
Great. Thank you very much for having me, and I hope it's a productive conversation afterwards. So I'm not presenting a program. I'm really trying to share how we in Cincinnati and catalyzed by the Children's Hospital are trying to think about the full production system for child health and well-being. And given many things are evidence-based, as was alluded to earlier today, how could we actually function optimally at full scale, and what are some of the required elements to put that into place? And the notion being that there are many, many actors, from family members, as we've heard, to a physician in a healthcare organization, to a job training person, that all of us have the capability to work better, smarter, faster, to deliver on what is known to be effective. And then, frankly, after reducing that noise, because we are operating effectively, making much clearer where the needs are for innovation and research. And just trying to anchor a little bit of the theory behind what I'm going to share. If you've ever seen the National Academy of Medicine's learning healthcare system approach, imagine taking that and trying to adapt it at a community-wide level for big dots outside of the healthcare system or beyond the healthcare system. So here's what I hope you hear resonating as I do sort of three deep biopsies into our work and then share a little bit about the methods. What I hope you'll hear is the importance of developing a shared vision and very clear outcomes, big enough dot outcomes that many, many sectors and families can line up underneath them. A focus in our work, particularly about the denominator, right? You hear a lot about of the folks who signed up for the program and stayed and got full dosage, we had good outcomes. We keep trying to get back to what are the population-based outcomes we're trying to move. How can it be that we're all great and yet we still have the same preterm birth rate that we've had for the last 20 years? In addition to big dots, using process measures that are granular and useful to change daily work, right? So on a daily basis, am I doing a better job than we did yesterday for the families in my practice or the kids in my classroom? And then always having full scale in mind so we don't come up with these grand programs that are unaffordable at scale, but really this notion of what are the right methods to develop something that, you know, if an iPhone can generate the richest company in the world, how do you get that kind of spread and that kind of uptake with that in mind from the start. Resonating with a couple of the points just made, staying child-centered and co-creating solutions with families. Otherwise, each of our sectors and nodes optimizes for ourselves, right? I don't really want to be in clinic at 6 a.m. to help a family make a decision about can I get to work and can my child be in healthcare. But if it is child-centered and the parent and the child are saying, here's where my key decisions need to be made, pediatric office and Head Start, how is it possible you're across the street from each other and aren't communicating and wasting time as I try to get the shot record across the street? Finally, using shared methods to get better every day. So to the extent we use the same language and think the same way about improving on a daily basis, how collectively can we make better, faster progress? So just to anchor the discussion, this is the kind of data we show in Cincinnati. The profound disparities, and I think this resonates with the task of the committee, right? So on your left is the mental health admissions for kids 0 to 17 in Hamilton County, where Cincinnati sits. That's the rate adjusted for the census numbers for kids in each of the 85 neighborhoods splayed across the bottom. So it's not really about what neighborhood, and I know you can't read the scale, but the notion that a simple glance at it tells you what incredibly profound inequities there are in mental health admissions and psychiatric problems across the county. Avondale and Price Hill are just two of the neighborhoods I've highlighted. The hospital sits in Avondale, Price Hill, and is mostly African American. Price Hill is a mixed neighborhood of African American, Appalachian, and Latina immigrants. And then on your right is the third grade reading proficiency by building for the Cincinnati Public Schools. And I just call out a couple of the schools situated in those neighborhoods. And again, so from mental health to, frankly, well-being, are the kids reading well in third grade as an indicator for their expected lifespan As one principal said, if I pass a kid from third to fourth grade and he's not reading, that child begins their slow death. And I found it very profound for a principal to be reflecting back on me what I have failed to do as a pediatrician. But then the notion that these two neighborhoods are the same, and I could show you the same graph for injuries, preterm birth, and so on, that it is those root causes that have their manifestations written into the bodies of kids across those high-risk neighborhoods. So this is the simplest, easiest, lowest cost study I ever did. I had a college student go to 25 families coming into our clinic from the zip code of Price Hill, and I just said, ask them what agencies and services they've obtained over the past 12 months. And they're sort of color-coded by types of services. So for 26 families, 12 of them have used the Price Hill WIC. There's Head Start. There's a Head Start preschool cluster. There's a school cluster. There's a Salvation Army cluster. But the notion that there are many, many folks trying to help, but it looks frankly like chaos, and nobody could do a Pareto of what's most effective or what are the types of relationships that should be strengthened as part of it. And imagine if instead of looking like this, it looked like this, right? Where all of us were lined up with a clear shared outcome that we're all shooting for. We all have a similar way of acting as part of a greater whole, that we know how to work synchronously with our neighbors right around us. And the power of acting in this way, to us, there's a sort of metaphors in Wikipedia and TripAdvisor, that if we actually know what we're shooting for and know how to act and sort of make the best of our pro-social behaviors, what is it possible to achieve? And that's where this notion of learning healthcare systems or learning networks sort of arises from. You know, Eleanor Ostrom won a Nobel Prize about the commons, right? How is it that competing fishermen can work to save the commons in something like this? How is it a whole bunch of agencies could work together along with families to achieve a better outcome? So does this method work in the community? We don't know, but we've now had about 8 to 10 years of trying it for complex illnesses. So Peter Margolis and Michael Seed, Carol Lannan and others, Mike Liu has been a supporter of this kind of thinking, have done learning networks for chronic illness. And I'll just walk you through these more to establish the credibility of the method in this application. And then the question is, can we apply it more broadly? So what you're looking at right now, I know it's a little bit small, but this is the percentage of patients in remission among kids with Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. So using these kinds of methods, an outcome, a shared way of working together, listening and co-creating with families, they've achieved a remission that's moved from 60% to greater than 80% with no new methods, no new medicines, no new surgeries, just a way of reliably applying best evidence, learning quickly from each other, and listening better to families who have many solutions of their own. So it's now spread to over 107 GI care centers. Here it is for elective preterm birth. So the Ohio Medicaid was paying a lot of money for obstetricians to deliver babies before 38 weeks with elective C-sections. Using these same methods, they've reduced by 50,000 the number of babies that were unnecessarily being delivered prior to 38 weeks and moving them to being delivered term. Again, collective action, all the OB, all the birth hospitals working together in a different way. Here it is, solutions for patient safety. Started with one children's hospital focus on safety, moved to all the Ohio children's hospitals. Now 130 hospitals learning from each other, clear shared set of outcomes, over $100 million estimated saved, and over 7,000 kids spared harm. And finally, this is for children with a single ventricle, very high risk congenital heart disease. And they've had a 45% reduction in mortality for those kids, where instead of each hospital sort of trying to outcompete the next one as to we know the best how to take care of that kind of illness, they're all working together and the families are playing a major part in the outcome. So an open source kind of learning network, again, think Wikipedia or TripAdvisor, of how do we contribute to a greater whole? And our question has been, can we apply this in the community for big dot outcomes? So here are the outcomes we're working towards and the commitment. It's the All Children Thrive Learning Network. 66,000 kids at 0 to 17 in the confines of the geographic area of Cincinnati, so clear denominator. Two goals around morbidity and mortality, two around thriving. Not surprising kinds of goals. We went through vision sessions with the community and so on. Reducing infant death, baking in the equity measure, reducing the disparity in pediatric admissions, focusing on those two high-risk neighborhoods. A measure of children thriving at age 5, and you can see some of the elements. They all have to be a pass to get a yes on ready at age 5. And then supporting the Cincinnati Public Schools for kids reading proficiently or above at third grade. So very big dots. Almost anyone I meet can say, hey, here's where I can find a place in this work towards those big goals. And then this notion of how do we organize, it's not, in a sense, a coalition with large strategic planning for 2 years. It's very much who are the first two or four groups who want to act differently, want to act collaboratively, want to be transparent about the results, want to share their failures, share their successes, and learn every day. How do you invite the next round in? And this is an ever-evolving list of groups that are involved according to sort of the outcomes. But if you just take third grade reading, the Cincinnati Public Schools, the Success by Six, Child Care, Head Start, Strive Partnership, and the clinics as an example, all now with sharing an outcome, sharing a theory and logic of way of working together and centered on families. So now I'll do a couple just deep dives into how we're doing. Infant mortality, the number one cause is preterm birth, extreme preterm birth. And using these methods, we started to work in the neighborhood of Avondale. Avondale, if you look to the right, has about 205 births per year, 16% preterm birth rate, quite high, about 2% extreme preterm birth rate. And what you see on the y-axis is the percent born at less than 28 weeks, so extreme preterm birth. And across the x-axis are the quarters, so about 40 to 50 births per quarter. And what you see there, again, this is vital stats-driven data, so population-based. Is about 1 to 2 kids being born extremely early every quarter. We brought together the two big OB practices and birth hospitals, the home visitors, the faith ministries, families themselves. We did 6 months worth of ethnographic work and brought families on as partners. And basically, after about a year of learning to work together, we have now 12 to 14 quarters in which we had zero extreme preterm births. You know, and if you were to distill out, it wasn't about they all finally got their glucose tolerance test, right? It was not the magic. What we think it was along the lines of being accountable to every mother and not just who came into my clinic that afternoon, but accountable to the denominator, building trust, as we just heard about, is so important. And then really connecting seamlessly, including if housing eviction was the number one thing on their mind, making sure that was what was addressed that day. We try to run it sort of as a population lab so we can simultaneously monitor other neighborhoods. So here's four other neighborhoods, three or four zip codes, showing it was not like there was massive gentrification over the last 3 years and everyone just sort of cleared out. So again, encouraging results. And we think it's more about the way of working together and being responsive and trusted in solving problems rather than any specific medical or healthcare intervention. And here's how we sort of thought about the system, and how each contributes to the whole, right? So if you say there's 205 births per year, we were looking for a 10% reduction, how do we think about the community? How do we think about who are the actors in the OB and delivery space? How do we think about who are the community care providers that have to be seamlessly connected? What are the basic needs that had to be solved? And then I sometimes think of this about like the Amazon Prime measurement system, right? Everybody's got to commit to these process measures for it to work, right? It's we got to have 90%, our aim, our goal, maybe aspirational, 90% in by 12 weeks, 90% referred to prenatal care, to home visiting or community health workers by 15 weeks. So it's not specifically about preterm birth or even about these measures. It's really about what is the whole system and where are all the fail points in the system that we think are contributing to the poor outcomes. And again, it was a classic case in which any single unit here could say, we get great outcomes, but collectively we had a bad population level outcome. And only by literally, I would get the two OBs and the home visitors in the room every other week, and we'd look at every single intake into pregnancy and try to learn, why did that one come in early? What was her support system? Why did that woman come in late? Let's talk about social risk. So a key part of that, sort of connecting seamlessly, right? We had one woman whose eviction due date was the date of her delivery, right? So what are you going to do about solving the social risks? And I'll just highlight a program we have in which physicians and lawyers are working closely together. So my practice sees about 60,000 Medicaid visits a year across our three clinics. Legal Aid of Greater Cincinnati is a fantastic civil legal aid shop. What we've done is figured out how to essentially ensure every single child coming in, those families get asked a series of social screeners. And in the process since 2008, as you can see, over 6,600 referrals, 600 residents trained in the social determinants, over 800,000, that's a low ball estimate because it took us a while to figure out how to estimate it, have had back benefits recovered. And because Legal Aid and Cincinnati Children's are focused on outcomes, We can talk about what are the legal outcomes that have been resolved, evictions resolved, special education cases resolved, SNAP denials resolved. And on the right, sort of monitor daily and weekly and monthly performance. And so just looking at the top one, we know how many referrals per 1,000 well child care visits each of the clinics are doing, and then can go have a conversation if someone says, hey, why is it one clinic is finding all the SNAP and Medicaid disruptions and other clinic is finding none? Or what's this sudden uptick in housing referrals? What's going on at the clinic? Using that data, we can begin to look at overlying patterns. Healthcare data alone, housing data alone may not be effective, but what you're looking at the right is then the city's housing code violation density and our patients with asthma mapped against it. And again, we can do this across the city, but now you put a physician and a lawyer in the same room and new patterns emerge. And so in fact, that was the lawyer looked at those dots in that corner and said, that's Colonial Village. We know there's an absentee landlord there. We know the roof are coming down. Let's go over there. And they started working on a tenant association. I'll move a little more quickly. Third grade outcomes. I'll just show this to say, so we're working with the superintendent and the assistant superintendent of the Cincinnati Public Schools. Don't worry about the details of this. It's really just a way, I think maybe Dr. Fisher mentioned earlier, make our theory explicit, right? So a big part of this work is what's the goal, what's a smart aim, and then what's our working theory, and then making sure everything we're testing is against a particular driver of that theory. And this work is done by the assistant superintendent, just with us supporting in thinking about it. Some early results, if you look at the grade 3 outcomes on the measure of academic progress from fall to spring of 2018 in the schools we were teaching them QI versus in the schools not doing QI, we're seeing some significant differences. The superintendent is really juiced up about this. We're training 150 teachers and reading specialists next week in the application of this, how do we get better every day kind of work. I don't have time to talk about behavioral health, but again, you can just sort of imagine there are many programs to promote behavioral health, but what's the continuum and how do they all work together from postpartum depression to behavioral health promotion to mental health in the schools? I'll just finish by focusing on the learning network methods. Family-centered design has been crucial. We actually worked with a design firm in town to get the voices of families very clearly into the work, and they are co-leading much of this work. So we also had families go and knock on the door, Brad Wenstrup and Rob Portman the other day, or a couple months ago around CHIP, right, that for the first time they were out there. They've been down to city council as well. This is sort of the smallest kernel of the quality improvement we teach. You know, what are we trying to accomplish? How will we know a change is an improvement? And what change ideas can we make that might result in improvement? And what's the testing cycle? And I can't tell you, I've had three educators, all with over 20 years of professional experience, say this past year has been the best professional year of their lives, right? So from having sort of large curriculum that just go into the classroom to how would I segment my population? How would I know at the end of the week whether this week went better than the last? The last is sort of design principles for this work. If anyone read like General McChrystal's book, A Team of Teams, like when you're operating in incredibly complex environments, sort of top-down instructional strategies don't work as well versus we all commit to this way of working together. And I'll just point the first one is equity is foundational to improving child's health. So I'll finish the last slide or two. This is actually an interesting paper. Jim, you were probably the editor of the journal at the time this was accepted. This was a network map of sort of the production system for care with kids with chronic illness. And this notion that family support agencies need to be connected to educational programs, need to be connected with pediatric practices. And the way I think we've tried to think about it is, what would that network look like to ensure all children thrive? So OB is connected to pediatrics, is connected to home visiting. Quality preschool is connected to public schools and to medical care, right? Legal aid, housing, and urban league are all part of it for jobs and resolution of problems and promoting benefits. And then public health, city council, and faith-based are all at the table. So where we are right now is every single one of these folks are at the table. They've all actually taken our improvement course. That's the superintendent of public schools, Greg Landsman's on city council, Shara Fisher-Jackson at Urban League, and all of us sort of committing for a population-based approach to improved outcomes and a different way of working together with families. So this is one of our mothers groups in Avondale, and they inspire us every day with their leadership. So again, I'll just finish by putting that back up there, shared visions, co-creation with families, and a shared way of working together. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kahn. Thank you.